Well, good morning, good morning. Come on in. Find a seat. Come on in. We are so glad that we can all come together and worship God. Such a cool thing when we as a community come together in the name of Christ. Powerful things happen. So let's have that attitude. We have a lot going on. You were handed bulletins when you came in the door, so make sure you are thoroughly reading through those with the weekly schedule on the back. And then there's an insert for the team that will be heading out like this, like basically middle of the night, Thursday morning. They'll be heading out, and they'll be gone for a couple weeks there. So take this card home. Remember to pray for them daily, and let's do that together as a community in the name of Christ as well. But let's watch this video and see all that's going on.
Media Ministry. Would you like to be a part of our media ministry team? Circle M on your Connect card. PowerPoint, sound management, and other things are needed, and you could be a great part of this ministry. Women's Bible Study, Kingdom Culture by Reverend Tara Beth Leach, begins Tuesday, September 11th at 9:30 a.m. Sign up in the foyer today. Reflecting God devotionals for the fall season are now available on a table in the foyer. Pick yours up today. Free books are available on tables in the foyer. Stop by and take as many as you like. If you would like to be an usher, please circle U on your Connect card and drop it in the offering plate. Know any parents? Parenting the Love and Logic Way is coming in September, so spread the word because this is a great class for parents in our community, our family, and friends. Are you busy on Wednesdays, 6:30 to 8:15? Well, our preschool class is still looking for a teacher's aide. Call Pastor Shana to find out how you can get started at 928-445-1136. Warm for Winter is October 27th from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. The donation barrels are in the foyer, and you can donate now through October 24th. Coats, pajamas, gloves, socks, blankets, quilts, scarves, and hats will all make great donations. Then make sure to fill out a Prescott Nazarene Connect card if you're visiting with us or you have updated information, and place it in the offering plate today. If during the service you have need of assistance, today's emergency team, Cody Gates and Ben Palm. Get Real Men's Expo 2018, Saturday, September 22nd, 8:30 a.m. to 1 p.m. at Yavapai College. Free breakfast at 8:30, free lunch at 12:30. Interactive outdoor activities. But most of all, Chad Robichaux, former decorated military veteran, MMA champion and author, shares how Christ saved him from PTSD, suicide, and infidelity. Men, you don't want to miss this great fellowship. Thank you for being here today, and let's prepare our hearts to receive from the Lord.
Amen. Good morning, everybody. Glad you're here. This morning, we're going to begin with our choir anthem, and it's kind of taken from Luke 19:40, and there were people just shouting and praising the Lord, and Jesus, when the Pharisees said, these people ought to shut up, that's a paraphrase, and Jesus answered, and he said unto them, I tell you that if these should hold their peace, the rocks would immediately cry out. Because of who you are. So this morning we're going to start and let the rocks know they can be quiet because we've come to praise him. Amen. All right, let's do it.
Amen. That'll preach.
Okay, I'm exhausted. But we just welcome you to come stand with us as we do that, as we let those rocks continue to stay silent, and we give God all the glory and worship.
Sing with me.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing, but now till I met you.
What happened?
You called my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. You called my name, your mercy has saved my soul.
And aren't you thankful?
Now your freedom is all that I know.
Oh, yes.
The old made new. Jesus, when I met you,
come on.
You called my.
Here's what we need.
I needed rescue. My sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm
display for all to see. You are light when the darkness closes in. You are hope, you have covered all my sin.
Thank you, Lord.
And you are peace when my fear is crippling. You are true, even in my wandering. You are joy, you're the reason that I sing. You are life, in you death has lost its sting. And oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever reign. Oh, you are more than my words could ever say. You are Lord, all creation.
Nothing compares to your.
strength always. I will not fear, this promise is true, and my God will come through always, always.
Trouble surrounds me, chaos around me, but my soul will rest in
I will not fear the war. I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way.
All of
my help is on the way. And oh my God, He will not delay. My refuge and strength always.
Hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
hope is built.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Christ alone, cornerstone, we prayed strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord alone.
When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale,
oh yes,
my anchor holds within the veil.
Sing it again, my anchor.
Take whatever posture you want, but let's just bow before our God. Let's fall on our face before our God and pray. Heavenly Father, God, we bring you praise right now, Lord God. We are confident that you're gonna come through always, God. That you are at work, that you are moving, that you are using this community for your powerful work. And God, I just pray that you would break through, Lord. Break through the busyness, break through the chaos, break through us running around, having so much going on, and yet really how important is any of it, Lord, compared to you, God. I pray that we would focus in on you. that your Spirit would come alive in a fresh way, Lord, in a new way, God, that you would fall upon us, rest upon us, and use us. And God, I pray that the enemy would have no control, no work, that darkness would have no room in our lives, in this place, as we go, Lord God, in temptations and struggles and trials and everything that comes at us, Lord. I pray that your light would overcome all, even glimmers of darkness, Lord. So I just pray that you would move mightily, God. And right now we bring it all before you, God. We surrender to you. We know that you are the Lord, that you are the Lord of the good stuff, and you are the Lord of the trials. You are the Lord of the storm. And God, we just cry out to you. We don't want to go any other place but straight to you, Lord. So right now we just ask that you would carry it, whatever it is, Lord, that we would lean into your strength, that you would be the comforter of all comforts, and work mightily in us so that we can then be used as vessels for your kingdom work in those amazing ways as well. So God, we just praise you. We ask that you be glorified, that you would take us no matter where we're at in any situation, and that you would bring good in that. God, that you would work. And we just say thank you for who you are. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Okay, ushers, if you want to come down, it's time for our tithes and offerings. And just want to say thank you for what you are giving. You're blessing the church with everything that you give from the heart, and that's all we ask for you to do, is to give from your heart as we bless God with what he has blessed us with. He blesses us with everything that we have. So let's bless him with our tithes and offerings. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for this wonderful day and blessing us with all that we have, Lord. We would have nothing if it wasn't for you, so we want to give back to you, Lord, with our tithes and offering. We'll give what we can, and we praise you in everything that we do. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
When my boy was just about 5 years old, maybe, 4 or 5 years old, we went over to my sister's house, and she had a pool in the backyard, and my son wanted to jump in the pool. He hadn't really learned the skills of swimming yet, and I sat on the back porch to watch him. My brother-in-law came by and said, would you like a magazine to read or something while you're sitting here? I said, no, I don't need anything to distract me. I'm gonna keep my eyes on my boy. And he was playing by the side of the pool, hanging on, and as the, you know how the pool at the edge kind of has a gradual slope to the deeper part. He could stand on that slope and kind of hang on to the edge and sort of bounce. He could bounce and then grab the edge and bounce and then grab the edge. I never took my eyes off of Wesley, my little boy. He's now 6'2" and a worship director up in Michigan, and he's amazing. I kept my eyes, I just watched him. Never took my eyes off of him. And there was one moment where his bouncing was too far down on the slope, and I could see from the side of the pool he could no longer reach the edge, and he went down. There was no hesitation, and there was really no alarm. I just jumped up. I was about 5 steps away, and I grabbed him by the arm and pulled him up. He gasped for air, and we realized that we better be a little more careful here. I just want to encourage you today. God never takes his eyes off of you. The old phrase, he watches you like a hawk. but not to prey on you, but to protect you, to pull you out when you go under, to grab you by the hand when you're just about ready to stumble. And oftentimes when we don't even know what's ahead, his eyes are fixed on us, just like they are fixed on the sparrow. Tell me, why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows fall? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is he. For his eyes are the sparrow, and I know his eyes on that little sparrow, and I know he watches me. Well, I sing because I'm happy, and I sing because I'm free. His eyes on the sparrow, and I know that he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. His eyes on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I know he watches me. Yes, I know that he watches me.
Pastor Killen, will you come up here and join me on the stage? There he is. All right, we have something wonderful happening this week. It's taken a long time in the works, I believe about 2 years, if I'm correct. But we have a team going to Sri Lanka this week, and it's going to be a blessed time for them. They're going to learn a lot from this trip. And, you know, I want us to gather together to pray for them so we can send them off properly so that they will have a good trip. Prayer never hurts anybody. In fact, that's what we should always be doing, is praying. But we have our members here, which are Pastor Ira Brown, Debbie Cox. So if they will come up, if they're here, please come up on the stage. I'm sorry, come up on the stage as I call your name, so we can recognize the team as they're going to go. We have I just call her Anna Banana because I can't say her last name. I'm sorry. Is she here? And we have Ben Palm, if you'll please come up. Joan Pirtle. And we have Celestine Sisko. We have Alan Sotson, Ellen Wyatt. And we have three others from another church from around our district that are going to go, which are Tony Henry. And let's see, who else? Tony Henry, Ariel Nimi, and Judy Holm that are going to go also. Now, I don't know, next slide. I don't know what's on the next slide. So this is the progress that they've made already. You know how Pastor Ira was worried that it would never get started? Well, it's almost finished. So all they're going to do now when they go there is plaster the walls. I don't know if they're going to get you up on the roof at all. Yes, you're going to plaster walls. You're going to do the wax on, wax off thing. So you're going to be plastering some walls. And hopefully they don't do that before they get there, but that's what they're going to be doing. And the next slide, if you could please. That's it. All right. So what we want to do now is ask everybody, so you can see our group here that's going. I hope you guys are ready for this trip. You're going to be blessed for the trip. I know, Ben, you just got back. And off you go again. Thank you for going. So if you guys, if you would come down to the front now, line up down here, please. And I would like to ask if three of our ladies would come up, any three, so that you could be a stand-in for the three ladies that we are not with us now from the district, because we'd like to pray for them. They would like a stand-in for them. Thank you very much. Now what I'd like to ask is everybody in the congregation to stand up, if you can. And let's come down here in the front as much as you can. We'll start with the front. Let's lay hands on every one of these so we can send them off, those who can. If you can't, then just extend your hand out when we pray, and that'll be like you're here with us. But as many as can come down to the front to send them off, that would be fantastic. And we'll give you a moment, and then Pastor Killen's going to pray for the team.
Just want to say that I believe in working witness, and I've been where, at least in the area, general area, where these are going, so I know a little bit about the trip, and I know a little about what's happening, but they are going as our ambassadors. They're ambassadors of Christ, but they're ambassadors of Prescott Church of the Nazarene. And so we want to pray for them, not just now, but you've got that card, and if you'll take that card and pray for them daily, that God will be with them and protect them and use them in a very unique way. Let's pray together. Our Father, as we come to you today, we just want to pray for these who are going as ambassadors from this church, but most of all, as ambassadors for Christ to a faraway country that most of us know nothing about. We pray, dear God, that you would help them as they prepare in these next few days, and then on Thursday morning early, they begin their travel around the world. We pray that you would just watch over them. We know, dear God, the possible dangers and difficulties that could be there, but we know that you are a God who is able to not only go before them, but to go with them and protect them and use them in a very special way. And so, our Father, we pray right now that your blessings would be upon this team, that you would help them, dear God, to sense in a mighty way your presence. And dear God, as they travel and as they arrive, and dear Lord, though they'll be tired and weary, and though, Father, they'll be in a new culture, will you help them to have that sense that you are working through them to bring, dear Lord, your glory, dear God, to this country and to this city, this town to which they're going. We thank you for the work that's already been accomplished. We thank you for what they're going to do. And we pray that you would help them, most of all, as they interact with those who are there, that, dear God, there might be a sense of your presence. We know, dear God, that each one of these who are going to be changed as they sense, dear God, your work, dear Lord, in this faraway land, but realize that there are brothers and sisters with those whom they've never met before through Jesus Christ our Lord. And so, Lord, again, we ask that you would go with them, you would protect them, you would help them, dear God, to sense your presence. And, dear God, may they come back, dear God, with reports of victory, reports, dear God, of how you have intervened and for the miracles that you have performed. And, dear Lord, we pray all this to your honor and to your glory. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. Amen.
Remember that show, To Tell the Truth?
My name is Ira Brown. No, my name is Ira.
As you can tell, I am not Ira Brown. I am Rich Gomez, one of the associate pastors here and pastor of worship. And it's a privilege to come before you and minister and speak to you. I'm going to keep it brief, which Pastor Ira can't say. But anyway, he's not here. That's right. Well, laughter does good like medicine. And I'm going to be speaking on handling the stress of life. And if you don't think that it's stressful to take over when Pastor Ira is not here, you're not standing up here. And you know, there's an old joke that people say, and it's actually true, actually. They did a survey and they said most people, what is the most feared thing to do? And people chose public speaking. Second was death, which means you'd rather be in the box than up here talking. So anyway, so I just came back from a pleasure trip. I took my mother-in-law to the airport, and now they get such a bad rap, you know. No, but I've been going to the doctor. I'm going to be having some spinal surgery soon, and I appreciate your prayers. I hope not to be gone long, but, you know, I always think about this doctor that gave a man 6 months to live, and then he found out the doctor said he couldn't pay his bill, so he gave him another 6 months. And Phil, who did such a beautiful job this morning on the offertory, that was just so moving. Really appreciate it. He went to the doctor the other day. The doctor said, Phil, I'm guarantee you're going to live to be 62. And Phil said, I am 62. He said, what did I tell you? So, all right, let's move along into the message, and I'll stop doing that. I do want to say this, though, to begin with the message. You know, you can't impart what you don't possess. And for me, as a young man, I shared this with the choir recently, that I dealt with a lot of anxiety, depression. At 18, 19 years old, I spent from probably the time I was 19 till sometime in my early, like, 20th birthday, about a year and a half, where I could not leave my house. I had agoraphobia. If I went to the front door and stepped out, I'd be like this. So I want you to know that the person you're seeing up here today is a whole different person. And I especially want to say to young people, you may face a lot of stuff, and you may face a lot of stress, but hang in there, because God's for you. and he will bring you through it. He really will. And so that's kind of what drives me to this message today. And if you wouldn't mind, I'm going to pray. Father, just help us this morning to receive what you have for us. And let everyone remember everything that is from you. And they can forget anything I say that's not of you. But Lord, just help them to absorb this morning as we focus on you and as we give you all the glory. And I thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak to your church, our family. In Jesus' name, amen. So I'm going to read from Mark 12, verse 30. It's up on the screen. It says, "And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength, because this is the first commandment." And we're going to tie that and see how that actually helps us to come to the place where stress can become less and less. There's a man who is named Howard Hendrick who said, "I never met anyone who planned to have a mediocre life, but I have met a lot of mediocre people." And so you have to make a decision in your life. And then the first one of your little blank spaces that you have in your bulletin is this. This is what you need to decide, that you will be fully engaged. And my way of getting you fully engaged was leaving blank spaces in your bulletin. so that you would have to write it down or at least get the tape. Anyway, they don't use tapes, do they? No, okay. And again, in Mark 12, he said, "Loving the Lord your God with your heart, your soul, your mind, your strength, all of it." So to be fully engaged means you have to love with all your heart. And that means you have to have that passion. Without heart, we lack love. And you ask yourself, what am I passionate about? What really is my driving motivation? I can tell you in my life, being a worship pastor for now 37 years, that it's easy for me to be passionate about worship and about the Lord. And I have to make that distinction sometimes, having come from an entertainment background, that it's not a performance and that I have an audience of one. And when I realize that, I take my guitar and I face a wall where nobody is and I just worship him. And that's being fully engaged for me. And there are things that you do that make you fully engaged, but you have got to take the time to do that. So the first thing we see is without passion, we're going to, of our hearts, without heart, we lack love. In our soul, we must determine our purpose, because without soul, our lives lack meaning. And then with all of your mind, that means you got to set your priorities. And we have, sometimes our priorities get all messed up. We allow things in life to distract us, and we'll talk a little bit about that later, but that's some of the things we do. So without mind, we lack choices. And I had a note up here I wanted to read about that, so I think it's good. There it is. It says, again, this the same gentleman I quoted earlier, he says, "You're free to make choices, but you are not free to escape the consequences." Right? Isn't that true? You can make all the choices you want, but there will be. A man shall reap what he sows. And so we have to be careful that when we love with all of our mind, it's a choice. All right? And then finally, with all of our strength, that's power. And without that, his strength, we will lack ability. And so we have to be complete. That's why when it says in there, all of your heart, all of your mind, all of your strength. You know, how much does God want? All. We have to give him all. And I can tell you personally, that's not always the case in my life. I'm sure it's not in yours. Because distractions of life come. Things happen in our families, with our children, at work. But it's that making that choice, making that decision that no matter what's coming around you, that you will be all in. And that's the way we want to be. And so that brings us to a place where the way to do that, I think, is to check your gauges. Nancy, you can throw that up, I think, next slide. Thanks.
Here you go. So that gauge isn't too bad. It's kind of almost full. So we have to check those gauges, and this is the reason. We have to find out if spiritually, are we close or are we far? And that's, again, all of these things that I'm going to be telling you this morning are just things for you to kind of chew on and say, okay, you know, as we do each one, kind of just ask the Lord, Lord, am I as close as I need to be right now? Or am I kind of getting drifting and I'm getting a little far? The next one is, and this has to do with your soul, am I positive or am I negative? Do I dwell on things that are more negative because of the doctor's report or because of this or that? Or do I believe that the Lord is my God and that I'm positive in those things? And then in your mind, and you need to be focused or distracted. You either will be one or the other. So we have to get ourselves focused on what the Lord is doing in our lives. And then with strength, is your strength high or is it low? And again, these are just things for you to mull. Kind of think about whether they are, where you are, and how you're going to do that. So the next thing is, how do we live fully engaged? We have to live engaged. And I think the way we do that, do we make it more than a theoretical theology? In other words, is it just theory, or are we experiencing this every day in Christ? Because we need to. We have to. Boy, I'm so glad I got drinks. Normally, if I'm singing, I'm not allowed to have that. No, I don't know if I am. But by the way, Walmart, $10. This stays cold all 24.
Hear the ice.
It's been in there all night. Anyway, I'm sorry. All right. So here's the thing. To be fully, and you see it on the screen, to be fully engaged, you must follow the directive of Jesus. And here's the way to wisely disengage. There are times, you know, you need to be engaged and you need to be fully all in. But in your life, if you don't wisely disengage, you won't have that all-in experience because you'll be distracted. And you need not to be. And there is a Matthew 11 verses 28 through 30 says, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I'm gentle and lowly in heart, meaning he's humble, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. How many want to have a restful life where you're resting in Jesus? Amen. I do too. And I have, as I said earlier, because of the stresses as a young man, suffering from extreme anxiety and depression and all kinds of things. I remember I was getting ready. It was opening night on Broadway for Beatlemania, which, for those who don't know, I played George Harrison in the show on Broadway. And I remember sitting back there. Now, at that point, I was 28 years old, but I was still dealing with a lot of this. And I was looking at the door, the stage door, and I said, well, here's your choice. You can go on stage and do this thing for 2 hours, or you can run out that door and you'll never do it again. And that was a serious moment. And I'm able to laugh now, but I must tell you, I was sitting in the back like this. And we had rehearsed for 6 months. We were in a studio 5 days a week. And, you know, I remember Art Garfunkel came into our, because a lot of people where we rehearsed in Manhattan rehearsed in the same facility. And Art Garfunkel came in, we were doing one of the Beatles songs, and when it was over, he started clapping. He said, that was incredible. So we were feeling really good. And during that whole time, I felt wonderful. But when it came time to engage, I was like, felt so inadequate and so fearful. So I'm speaking this message to you about stress again, because of personal experience and because of what God has done for me. He's given me his peace. And so once I started leading worship, I have never had any moment like that in my life where it felt like I just can't go out. Because I wasn't going out there because of me. I was now going out there because of him. And that's all the difference. You guys, the Coxes, you know, when you're there and you're teaching, it's, you know, there's no fear there for you because you're like, God, we're just here, you know, as a conduit for you to flow through and do your work. And many of you have that same experience. And so I just encourage you, you know, again, I only mention that because it's so important sometimes to look at somebody and realize they're human too. Ira is human too. All of us, whether we're on staff here or we work here or we minister here, we give our time to things here. So many of you are such a blessing to everybody here. And they don't even see the things that you do, but God does. And so we'll just bless you for that. But looking at this, it's a matter of taking on the yoke of Christ. And of course, you've heard that for many, many years, to be yoked, evenly yoked with him. So that's an important thing. So here's where I want to take you, and that is simply this. Make sure that you don't mismanage your life. And I think that was one of my issues, actually, because I thought it all kind of rested on me. And when you do that, you know, you're taking on way more than you can possibly ever take on. So here's some of the things to remember from that scripture. Do not misunderstand who your source is. Jesus said, come unto me. So that's your source. So when you have those moments, that's a wonderful thing to remember. I'm not going to misunderstand. I'm not going to think my job is my source. I'm not going to think, you know, my health or this or that or something else is why I'm here. I'm going to remember that I can come to him because he invited me to do that. And then do not miscalculate your own strength, for he says in that scripture, you who labor. And he understands that there's a part of our lives and things that we do where we're laboring. And that's not a bad thing. You know, it's not a bad thing to work. But you can miscalculate your own strength instead of doing it in the strength of the Lord. And that's kind of what I said before about my own experience worshiping. It's like, you know, I could feel a little scruffy vocally or maybe not up to it on the guitar. But I come out because I know it doesn't, that much doesn't matter as long as I don't miscalculate what this is about. And even church in that regard, you know. So keep that in your hearts and minds as well. You labor. What happens when you labor? You get heavy laden. You get under it. So don't let that happen. Remember who your strength is. And then don't misplace your priorities. And that priority in that scripture is to take his yoke. Don't yoke yourself up with something that isn't, you know, because that's no yoke. Excuse me. All right. That was horrible. That was really bad. All right. But you don't really, in seriousness, don't ever misplace priorities. That's so important. It's so, again, it's so easy to find a place where you mess up because you've put this ahead of this. And Christ is trying to remind us, listen, yoke up with me and you'll have it. And the other is not to mishandle your activities. Jesus says in that same scripture, he says, learn from me. So if we're going to yoke up with him, then we have to learn from him. And the way that we as believers do that, of course, is to get into the word. You know, God stands behind his word to perform it. And we know that not one punctuation mark is not going to be, every bit of that is going to be fulfilled, amen? And so it's so important for us not to mishandle those activities and to learn from Christ. And then also, don't misdiagnose the problems in your life. Because Jesus said also, again in that scripture, you will find rest for your souls. So we have a tendency to think what we need to do. We diagnose ourselves so much, so many times, especially you go on the internet. Let's see, WebMD. Ew. Especially if you're a hypochondriac. And you're, oh my God. Anyway. So don't self-diagnose, but rather, as Jesus says, find rest for your souls. Because many times, I can sum up a little bit. Sometimes we don't realize how much our problems are inward. And not other people. It's so easy to look at somebody else and say, I wouldn't have this problem if it wasn't for so-and-so. You want to just spend that time with God that brings you to that place that helps you in so many ways to assimilate this scripture. I'm going to read it again now that we've kind of looked at it. Let me just say it one more time. He says, come to me, all you who are laboring and are heavy laden. And what will he do? He'll give you rest. How many of us could use a good rest in him? I really mean it. I think so. All of us can just say, God, I need to rest in you more than I have. Even those of us who have found some rest, we need to find the place where we are really resting in Christ. And he continues, says, and take my yoke upon you and learn from me. You know, sometimes we'll read these scriptures, we go so fast through them, we don't stop and spend that time and say, okay, I need to learn. There are things Christ wants to teach me that are specific to my walk with him. Amen? You have a very specific walk with God. You are not, I mean, your DNA is you. Your fingerprints are you. You know, you are so uniquely made. God has made each one of us. And we're not one of us is just alike. That always is a marvel to me. But to be able to learn from him is so important. And he says this because, and King James says, for I am gentle and lowly in heart. And I said before, because of his humility, he's saying, you can come. Because he took on flesh, he understands what we go through. He knows our lot in life, if you will, because he himself emptied himself and became like us. And what does he say? When you do that, then you will find the rest that you're looking for, the rest for your souls. The reason being, because what Christ has for you, his yoke, is easy and his burden is light. So finally, Matthew 16:26, he says, for what profit is it to a man if he would gain the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? So important, because if we don't follow Christ's directive, we will live in what I refer to as the B zone instead of the A zone, which is Christ. But the B zone is you will be busy, you will be behind, and eventually you will be buried. And I don't mean that literally, but you'll be buried under all the junk of life. You'll be buried in all the things that are taking your attention away from the things that it most needs to be on. And so don't live in that zone. That is not a place that God intended for us to be. Now think about this. What does it mean then for us to come to him? I think I have a few things I just want to share with you. And it's this. Come with an attitude of trust. I think when you first come to the Lord, that's something that you have to learn as you walk, to trust God. And I know as a young believer, it seemed like God would make, you know, there would just be things happening that, because, you know, one quick example, I was, some of you know, because I've taught on cults here, but that I was a Jehovah's Witness for a while. And when the Lord came into my life, I prayed one night and I prayed, Lord, bring the pastor of this church that somebody who was leading me to Christ took me to, and somebody from Jehovah's Witnesses. And this was, again, me. I'm just a baby a Christian. And the next day, I got a doorbell ring, and the pastor from the church that I went to showed up just to see how I was doing. Excuse me. And what was interesting was, it didn't dawn on me to think that, well, he, you know, this was, oh, God, you're answering my prayer. Didn't at all, until the doorbell rang 15 minutes later, and it was the district assembly leader of the Jehovah's Witnesses. And then I thought, oh, see how fast I catch on? And I won't go through that whole story, but suffice to say that I looked at that guy. He had said something, and I said, I've been studying with you for X however long. I said, and that's a lie. And out of the corner of my eye, I saw the pastor, my pastor going like whoa. But he knew that I was getting it, that God was revealing Christ in me, the hope of glory, and that there's truth and there's a lie. Amen? So just wanted you to know, the attitude, you have to learn that attitude of trust and to trust God in all those ways. That really helped me so much. Then you have to learn it as an action of separation. Because Jesus modeled this by frequently getting away to fellowship alone. And that's such a big thing too. We get so busy with life and things, it's very difficult for us. Jesus actually saw the value in, you know, saying, this is good, but this is good too. I need to get away with the Father if I'm going to be effective. And so there's a saying that I have, which is, if you don't come apart, meaning come apart with the Lord, then we're going to fall apart. And you know that's true. And again, in my Christian walk over many years, there are days where I went, you know, why is this happening? And guess what? When you feel, and you've heard this probably 1,000 times, but when you feel like God has moved, guess who? Who actually moved? He has no shadow of turning, so he didn't move. But I've experienced in my life when I've moved and realized, oops, gotta get back over here. So that's a wonderful example of Christ for us, that if we don't come apart, the tendency is we will fall apart. So especially here in church activity and in your walk with the Lord, be honest about your work. And be honest about your workload and also your responsibility. Because labor is physical, but responsibility can be mental. Because you realize you have, for example, in my case and Phil's case, we have the choir, we have the band, we have, you know, we have responsibilities that require you to be thinking all the time, want to keep it fresh, want to keep this happening and that happening. And so for labor, he gives us strength. And for responsibility, he gives us his peace so that you don't carry any of this without him being completely involved with you. And so that's so important. I love that. Just hang on that for a second. For your labor, enjoy his strength. And for the areas of responsibility, as I just pointed out here, or if you're Pastor Ira and you have the responsibility of the whole church, he gives you peace for that. And he lets you know, yeah, I have you there, but I'm with you. And I will be with you and walk you through it. And so that's so important for us. And then finally, I just want to say this from the scripture. And this is probably the whole summation of this. And it's just so simple, and it's something, again, that you know so well. Casting all of your care on him. Why? Because he cares for you. Amen. I don't know about you, but there were times when I'd gone through some of the things I've walked through, where here it was like, you really do care for me, right? You know, because you're not all in. And I think that was my issue, was how all in am I going to be? And when you do get to that place where you realize, you know, it's so much not about you, but what he will do in you and through you, because of who he is, that we get to that place. So I hope, it was kind of a brief message, I think, but I hope that you'll take some of those things and really apply them, you know, revisit them. Because again, there's nothing new here, I think, but revisit it, because it will stir you up again to say, yep, with all of my heart, with all of my mind, with all of my soul and all my strength, I'm gonna love God. Why? Because he first loved us. And when we get that together, then we have everything we need. Phil, if you want to come to close the service, Phil and I are going to sing a song that...
It's a beautiful song called The Power of Your Love. I think many of you will know it. The lyrics will be on the screen. But more importantly, if you want to make that connection today, and just feel free, kneel at your seat or come down here, whatever the Lord places on your heart. But the lyrics to this song say, Lord, I come to you, so let my heart be changed, let it be renewed. It goes along with what I wanted to minister today from God to you and to me. I told my wife, I said, I think I'm preaching this message. So she handed me a mirror to bring. She said, while you're preaching, just hold it up every now and then. And I forgot to bring it, but honestly, she did. And so I just pray really seriously that if you need to and you just want to do that, just as a moment, I'll ask other people, just let people come. We don't need to surround them. Let them have that moment. Be all in for God as we worship him together. Lord, I come to you, let my heart be changed, renewed, flowing from the grace that I found in you. And Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see in me, they will be stripped away by the power of your love. Now hold me close and let your love surround. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for your love. Thank you for helping us by your Spirit to be all in all the time, to rest in you, take your yoke upon us, to learn from you, to understand the greatness of our God and the call we have on our lives. And help us, Father, to come apart when it's necessary so we don't fall apart. And that we would understand the will of the Lord concerning each one of us as individuals and as your church, the body of Christ. We are nothing without you, but your word says that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. And so, Father, that's my prayer, and it's also, as we close, my prayer for those who stood here today and have prayed over, and even as we end this, just one more time to remember, that they are fulfilling a calling. They are fulfilling your destiny for them, that you surround them with grace and peace, your protection and love. And Father, you do that for every one of us here today. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful day today. Lord, I come to you. Let my heart be changed, renewed. It's flowing from the grace that I found in you. And Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see in me. They will be stripped away by the power.